All right, very great. Welcome everyone. The welcome wagon is extended, as every video is here you see on this channel. It's going to be very intense. You're going to be shocked by what you hear. This is the whole path, the path of, it's kind of spiritual shock treatment. It's always going to be better than you believe, than you think, than your belief system can handle. Your belief system is going to be rocked. There's no question about it. This is what the spiritual path is all about. Therefore, there are several parameters that have to be met. Otherwise, you're going to flounder and the wheels are going to come off at some point. Now, when you're young, you say, I can just go fast and fake it and think fast and I don't need to worry about stuff. As you're old, you say, I can't have the will to really do it. So you're in between this old age and youth. The mentality has to be smart. You have to be really smart and do what works. So you can't be guided entirely by youth nor by old age. All right? You cannot. Those are two extremes. You have to avoid those two extremes. And what you have to do is you have to be really smart and you have to handle the shock properly. Manage your success. Manage the shock of your success properly. You're going to hear adamant teaching, unapologetic adamant teaching here, which is going to rock your belief system severely, guaranteed. How do you handle that? How do you manage the shock? This is all important. So we say you must come to any genuine spiritual teaching in a mood of repentance, which means I expect to have my belief system rocked, because my belief system is far from having the right focus and emphasis, and I still have some significant recognitions I still need to make. Okay, significant. And this means you say, I'm going to get rocked. There's no question about it. This is the mood of repentance. So you already know what to expect. I'm going to get my belief system's going to be rocked. I'm going to be shocked, and I'm going to have to manage my shock. Those are the three parameters that you have to have. Now the youth thinks, we're so quick and agile, and we got so much energy, and it doesn't matter if I'm shocked. That's okay. I'll just keep going and going and going. It doesn't matter if I don't sleep the night or the next night, or you know, I can keep going and going. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. I can keep myself motivated. I can keep, you know, I'm used to shock. I love shock. I enjoy, you know, there's a thrill. You know, it's youth. That doesn't work. That absolutely doesn't work. You're going to fixate, you're going to stagnate, you're going to fixate, you're going to obsess, you're going to get into all sorts of trouble if you try to do it that way. And of course, the old people say, well, you can't expect me to do that, I'm getting older. No, that obviously doesn't work. I'll have pity on me, you know. Yeah, that doesn't work either. You know, sure, we have pity, but it's not effective. So even if you're older, you have to have a slightly younger attitude. And if you're younger, you have to have a slightly older attitude, like that. And you say, I have to manage the shock in the right way, and we have the right way here, and I have to get proficient at this. There's no way around it. Absolutely no way around it. The idea that we can just use like youth to just think real fast and I'll just throw a bunch of concepts and a whole bunch of words and somehow conceptually I'll get around this is ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. Okay, it doesn't work at all. So what we do here is we go full stop in the wow. When we're, the shock builds up in us, we recognize it. We say, wow, this is really rocking my boat. Something really fierce. And I have to acknowledge this and accept it and be grateful for it and look at it in a positive way. Glasses half full. Say, great. I'm really shocked. I'm really rocked. And now I can't really take anymore. I want to stabilize a little bit. So I'm going to go into this neutral mode where I neither judge for truth nor against it. Neither for nor against. And in this neutral mode, you refuse to engage dialogue. You're just in a neutral, let me take a break-ness, okay? Now again, young people will say, well, I don't need to take a break. I got plenty of energy. But their belief system is still being shocked like this. When if older people say, well, yeah, I don't need to take a break. I need to just stop here. You know, no, take a break where you're still intense, you're still focused, but you realize, I just need to calm down a little bit here. This, you know, I need to readjust to what I've heard. This is the path. This is what has to be done. We have gotten so sidetracked from truth in many, many ways. And when you find out about it, you might be upset. You might say, "Wow, you know, holy cow." I know that's true, but it's shocking to me. I got so sidetracked, and I'm so upset. This is shocking. Well, full stop in the wow. And so the ego tries to engage us in concepts. No matter what the concepts are, it doesn't matter to the ego. Because as soon as you start engaging in concepts, in an inner dialogue, it's ambiguous. It's very ambiguous. The ego can automatically take an opposite position and start then saying, "Well, wait a minute," and start pulling you into more and more and more and more conceptuality until you're very, very confused, very, very, very upset, feeling guilty, feeling uncertain. And this is what the ego does. This is what the ego does. It contracts you into fear. So when you're shocked, you must not be contracted into fear, okay? Therefore, I say, don't judge for truth, because in judging for truth, you're getting into a conceptual mode, and the ego will then grab a hold of that and use that to wrestle with you, and then wrestle you down into fear or agitation and all that. So you have to go into this full stop in the wow mode, neutral mode. Well, like, I'm both reacting and not reacting. Yeah, I am reacting and I'm also not reacting. I am conceptualizing, and I'm also not conceptualizing. So you go into this neutral mode where you can't be pinned down, you can't be polarized, you can't be pinned down in any way. And you're just quiet. You're not thinking, you're not planning, you're not strategizing, you're not advancing, you're not retreating. So this is the absolute cornerstone of spiritual success. Without this, you're going to get stuck and fixate somewhere, without a doubt, and then try to convince everybody else that this is as far as anybody can go. You say, "Well, no, anything beyond this is crazy. This is as far as you can go." And then you try to be a pundit, you know, when you're stuck. This happens to the best of us. So we have to acknowledge that we didn't quite have the right tools and start using the right tools. The folly of youth and the folly of old age trap us, and we have to push both of those aside and say, "No, I'm going to take this middle way where I'm not going to listen to either of those, that folly, and I'm going to be just wise right now, and I am going to practice this full stop in the wow." Where I don't really have a position on anything. You see, full stop in the wow, you don't have a position on anything. The ego will try to say, "Well, what's your position on this?" Like it wants to debate you. It wants to debate. The ego loves debating. And you say, "What's your position?" "Well, I'm both for it and against it." "What do you mean?" "Well, I both have meaning in this and non-meaning in this." "What are you saying?" "Well, I'm both saying something and not saying anything." Don't take a position. You're in a neutral mode. Do not take a position, because right now you're in shock. You're in shock. So without this, nothing can be done. You're going to run into troubles. Everyone will run into troubles. And very few are handling it properly, which is why there's very little success. Of course, I tried to find some way around this. No one wants to admit that, "Hey, I'm just shocked. That's it. I'm shocked. And so let me just let the shock wear off. That's it." We don't want to admit that. We say, no, I'm not shocked. My thoughts are somewhat similar along the line. This is not shocking at all. You know, we don't want to admit it. We don't want to admit that we've been off track, right? Or even derelict, off track. We don't want to admit we've been arrogant. We don't want to admit this. So, in other words, we don't want to repent. We don't want to admit, like, "Well, maybe there's something I need to hear that is like, I have really missed it. I have a blind spot." We don't want to admit this, but we have to. So, for example, this morning I had a dream, and I woke up from the dream. I remembered it, and it's quite stunning, quite stunning. So for me, that this is a wow, you know? I still have to, you know, full stop in the wow. Very shocking. It's very advanced, but that doesn't mean I'm not shocked by it. Just because you follow along doesn't mean you don't get shocked by the next step. You're always going to be shocked by the next step because it's looking at a place that you haven't looked at before. And you see that and you say, oh my gosh, this changes everything. This perspective really sheds new light on my entire belief system. So it's always going to be shocking. Your belief system is going to get rocked for sure. So take this attitude. I'm neither young nor old, no matter what chronological age I am, but I'm really wise and I'm glad to be shocked, because this I know this is means I really am taking a new fresh look at truth, not just something that's grafted onto the past beliefs, but a fresh new look. And for a moment I've been unapologetic about it, and I didn't walk it back at all, and I'm just looking at it and I see it, oh my gosh. And then you don't want to walk it back. See, you want to just unapologetically stop in the neutrality. You're not apologizing, nor are you defending it, because you're shocked. So don't let the ego pull you into trying to defend your new viewpoint, because you can't do it really very well, because you're in shock. The next day, if you do full stop in the wow, the next day you probably will be able to push forward, which today I have been able to push forward from the day before, where I was, you know, in a lot of strong shock. Now you say, well, if I'm in shock, strong shock every day, you know, how can I really be push forward, really be adamant teacher or something? Well, you can't until you really finish, really. I mean, you can't be a real world beater until you've really finished with it all. So you just have to be humble and pay your dues. There's no other way. I've been paying my dues my entire life. Let the ones who have truly finished, let them be the big dog world beaters, and you be their students, and then do the best that you can. That's how it is. And be happy. You know, you don't want to be some world beater when you're going to end up having to walk back everything you've said, because the pressure of this world is just absolutely nuts. I mean, everybody, you know, has to seemingly walk back a lot of stuff they say. Oh, I'm sorry. Did somebody disagree with me? Oh, God, let me walk this back. And, you know, no. The great teachers are unapologetic about the truth. The truth never walks back the slightest bit. And they tell us this. So we have no choice but to accept that truth is true and nothing else is true. No choice. Whereas the world is demanding, the ego demands that we walk that back. Say, hey, that's not fair. You know, that's not being fair to lies. You know, that's not being fair to this and that. So you just stay on the path and be successful every day. This is the best you can do. Best anyone can do. Now, I can't go out in the world and express all this directly to people, because I'd be forced to walk it back. They'd put pressure on me. Terrible pressure. And in order to be a teacher, you have to be unapologetic about the truth. Absolutely unapologetic about the truth. And it's the others that need to walk back the lies and arrogance. That's what needs to be walked back. It's arrogance that needs to be walked back. But of course, arrogance just keeps doubling down, projecting. And there's a religion of projection in the world right now. There's so many people now who think that they've discovered a new religion called projection. And that's all they do. That's all they do. It's amazing reading the comments on the internet about these volatile issues. And there's a group of people, basically mostly on the left, who simply all they're doing is projecting. Whatever insufficiencies they see in themselves, they project them out on others and then attack it there. But others, both sides do it. But I found it's a mania on the side of the left, a mania on the political correctness. Whatever they feel inside of them is not right, they project it on others and attack it there, and think that then it's not within them at all. This has become a religion. And this is diametrically opposed to truth. And so they think that it's truth that has to walk back and say, oh, I'm sorry, this is too strict, I have to say what that, well, yeah, lies are okay, walk it back. This never works. Will never help anyone. So You either basically are gonna get caught up in this political correct new religion, new world order religion, or you're going to be a humble, serious pilgrim on the path to salvation. One of the two. One of the two. There's no middle ground. You're either going to be getting heavily into projection and attack, or you're going to get into the mood of repentance and manage the shock. Those are the only two options anyone really has. And I think a lot of people just think, no, maybe there's some other option. I just don't want to really. There isn't. I mean, it should be obvious to people that in order to engage outside of the spiritual path, you fall into this other religion, which is a religion of insanity, religion of projection. And you have the high priestesses and priests of this religion of projection, of mental disorder, really. And you're expected to worship that, and you get pulled into that, and then there seems to be no way out. Addiction, you get addicted to accommodation, demands, all this, it's just horrible. And all because you're afraid of being shocked a little bit, you know, just a little spiritual shock. Oh, maybe I wasn't right about my beliefs. Oh gosh, you know. So you go to spiritual teaching admitting, I know I'm not right about my beliefs. Of course, everybody there say, they say I'm a sinner, meaning I'm missing the mark. The sin means to miss the mark. I know I'm missing the mark. I know I'm not hitting the mark. I'm not really, somehow, I can't find the right emphasis. So I know I'm going to be shocked by the truth. The truth will shock me. That's all. Well, what harm is there in that? And in fact, you'll enjoy being shocked and say, wow, this is great. I'm so glad I looked at this. Now, so here we go. I'm going to get shocked by this. So of course, you're kind of like, oh boy, here we go again. But it's either that or, you know, take your place in the madness of PC religion, of religion of projection, which disordered mind. Try to embrace a disordered, a deranged mind. Try to embrace a deranged mind. That's no fun for anyone. And then you mask it with sex, drugs, rock and roll, basically. You try to say, well, I got to get by this. This will work eventually. It's really tough now, but it'll work eventually. And it doesn't. It just gets worse and worse and worse. Whereas the spiritual path gets better and better and better. And it's still shocking. But what is shocking you is clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer truth. So you realize, wow, I really am getting it here. So, had this dream, and in this dream I realized, had a spiritual realization of drop all remedies. I have no remedies and all plans. I have no plans. I have no remedies. I have no initiative. I have no investment. RIP, I call it. Rest in peace. In order to rest in peace, we drop all remedies, all initiative, all planning, all plans. Now, ask yourself this question. What does perfection need to have remedies? Remedies for what? Does perfection need initiative? Initiative for what? Does perfection need plans? Plans for what? Let's get back to remedies. What does perfection need to pursue remedies for? Now, I realize in the dream that to pursue a remedy means you're also pursuing something that is out of whack, that needs the remedy. You have to have something that needs the remedy. So to pursue a remedy is to deny perfection, plain and simple. To pursue plans is to deny perfection. To pursue initiative is to deny perfection. You're saying, oh, I need this initiative to let's find remedies, let's get plans, let's, like that. And so this was very clear to me in the dream. And I said, wow, right. If you want to know that your perfection, you must drop your remedies, your initiative, and your planning. Okay, now this is saying it's completely shocking to our belief system. We believe that happiness comes from finding remedies, having initiative, and planning. This is what we're taught. But this is the ego. This is what deceives us, actually. Now, in this dream, once I accepted this, and I really did, I really accepted it. I said, this is true. I know this is true. Right. So I should not be pursuing a remedy for what ails me. I should simply be dropping any effort towards any remedy, to finding any remedy. And in doing that, you're also dropping all belief that there could be anything other than perfection that would need a remedy. That you're dropping the belief that there could be any need for a remedy whatsoever. And so you go into the default. What is our default? Our default is perfection. That's what we are. That's how God created us. What God created us can never be changed. What God creates can never be changed. We are still absolute perfection. We can never deviate from that perfection in the slightest bit. So to drop the search for remedies is to then to realize your perfection. To drop the search for plans is to realize your perfection. To drop the demand for initiative is to realize your perfection. So to realize a perfection, to rest in peace, R.I.P. It's easy to remember, R.I.P. In order to rest in peace, we need to drop our search for remedies, our initiatives, and our planning, our plans. To find this. We don't need to find anything. We default. We're already perfect. So R.I.P., easy to remember. Now, so I really accepted this. I got it in the dream. I really did. And then I looked up, and there was this bird on a branch above me, a beautiful bird. And I said, oh, bird, you're so friendly. I said, maybe most birds, they fly away. They don't. But maybe you seem like you might accept a hand in friendship. I reached up my hand towards the bird. And then the bird reached down towards me, and then the bird somehow transformed into a cat, and the cat came down my arm into my arms. And it was this wonderful cat. And for me, cats, the highest symbol of a cat is bliss here in this world, bliss. I had a cat that was just blissful, continuously blissful all the time. It was just quite extraordinary. Now, we say, well, this cat happiness, yes. But symbolically, as a symbol, cats can be used to symbolize bliss. So in the dream, what was really happening was the bird symbolized the freedom of our true nature, which is the reminder of which we call the Holy Spirit. Some call it the Word of God. It's the Holy Spirit. Some call it angels, messengers, etc. It's the Holy Spirit. So the bird there in the dream symbolized the Holy Spirit. And the bird was acknowledging, yes, you get it. And now from me, you cannot quite fly like I can fly yet, you see, but you can have bliss while you're here in this world. You can't experience the true freedom that I as the bird can experience, and yet you can experience the comfort of this very, very wonderful bliss that the cat symbolizes. The cats just love to just relax, so relaxed and not worried about anything. You know, the cat is just absolutely not worried and relaxed and just blissful right now. So this is what was symbolized in the dream. All I have to do in order to rest in peace is drop all remedies, initiative, and plans. Release the world from everything we thought it was. Release the world from everything I thought I wanted it to be. Release the world from that. Now, obviously, if you're a nature worshiper, a world worshiper, all this, you will not release the world from everything you think it is. You keep projecting on the world what you want it to be. But what Jesus says, release the world from everything you thought it was or wanted it to be. Just completely release the world. He says you must do this in order to experience the bliss. Which is why I say, you know, that the route of the pagans, the route of nature worshipers, the route of the goddess is what it is. Never works. It always fixates on projection. And just tries to find happiness in that. You have to put, you know, it fixates on remedies. So I can find a good remedy. Oh, it fixates on plans. I can find a good plan. No, let go of all remedies, all plans, all initiative. Because only then will we allow the inherent perfection of what we already are. We will allow that to be reflected in us as bliss here. That's the only way. And I've talked about how, for example, we try to blend truth and lies. And, for example, Christianity is a good example of that. initially they started out with truth, and then eventually people saying like, wow, wait a minute, this is too tough, it's very shocking. Let's blend truth and lies and it won't be so shocking, and it will seem like we've made progress. Oh, I'm not so shocked now, you know. And it'll speed it up, and it'll bring more people into the church, the pagans who are these goddess-worshipping pagans. If we you know, make it friendly to them, they'll come and say, oh, this is very similar to what we believe. Yeah, it's not so shocking. And they'll come in, they'll come into the church. So they blended truth and lies, or at least this is what they imagine. It's actually all a lie. If you try to blend truth and lies, it's all a lie. So they could, you know, be more market-friendly to those who, you know, believed in lies. And this is, you know, this is the PC, isn't it? Well, we don't want to offend the goddess worshippers, so let's say, yeah, we're goddess worshippers too, come on in. So the battle in Christianity was over the definition of Mary. This is quite extraordinary, that people really were not thinking so much about Jesus. It was what was all about Mary, and what do you call Mary? Yeah. And of course, Jesus ignored his mother for the most part. Didn't say anything hardly pro or con about her at all. It was non-factor, complete non-factor. And the apostles, non-factor. To early Christianity, Mary was a complete non-factor. But it was these pagans who said, wait a minute, for political reasons, for a lot of different reasons, they said, we want to grow Christianity, but we can't really grow it because there's not that many people who are, you know, purists about it. So how do we open it up to other people, you know, the Hellenized Jews who don't really want to leave Judaism, you know, the Mithraism, which was a very strong, powerful religion throughout the ancient world. You know, how do we make it more accessible to them? Let's make it really accessible. So they then had to define Jesus in a certain way. And in order to find Jesus in a certain way, they had to define Mary in a certain way. It was all important to them. Their Christology centered on Mary. And the debate was on whether we call Mary the Mother of God or the Mother of Christ. Cyril of Alexandria insisted it's the Mother of God. And that camp won out over Nestor. I believe he was the Archbishop of what, Constantinople? I believe that was Nestor. Anyway, he said, no, that's not right. Make it the Mother of Christ, but not the Mother of God. This is a big mistake. Now, even saying the Mother of Christ is a big mistake, but it's not as bad a mistake as saying the Mother of God, that's for sure. And Nestor lost and was banned as a heretic and took his teachings further east, and that's the Far Eastern Church. Became the Nestorian Church, which was flourished for quite some time, and as has then gradually, you know, with the conquests of Islam in that area, it went into decline. So this was the central issue, and has remained in the church. The Catholic Church is founded on the Creed, the Chalcedonian Creed, where they had this council and voted on the statement that Mary is the Mother of God. That is founded upon that. So in terms of Christology, this is like all important in order to say that Jesus had two distinct different natures, perfect human nature that was somehow perfect, and then divine nature was also perfect, and that these were separate natures, separate distinct natures, and yet they were also mystically one nature, with that one nature not denying the dualistic distinctness, and the distinctness not denying the oneness. And how this was possible, they call this hypostatic union. They use some Greek term which is very nebulous, which means the underlying identity or something. So they brought something in as duality, and they figured, well, duality can be made true. Truth and lies can both be true through this hypostatic union. And this then made Christianity accessible to the pagans, essentially. So sure, come on in. You can worship Jesus as a man, and you can worship Mary as the Mother of God, just like you worship your goddesses, who sun worship, which is, you know, Osiris, Isis and Osiris, and all the various sun worshiping of the earth as the mother, and the sun is the father, I mean, the actual star, the sun, the solar sun is the father, and then the vegetation is the son. Is the son of the mother, and of the combination of the mother, father, and the third part of the Trinity would be the son, which is the vegetation of the world, nature. Without the sun, they see, realize that nature, you know, doesn't happen. And without the earth, if you have the sun but no fertile earth, fertility, nothing, no vegetation happens. So you have the fertility of the earth, which is the mother, and the heat and intensity of the sun quickens the mother and brings about the vegetation. And this is nature worship. This is pagan nature worship. They have all sorts of religions, you know, based on this central premise. So they open the door to allow Christianity to become the religion of the empire. That's what their aim was. They wanted to spread Christianity. They said, well, if we can get the pagan empire to embrace Christianity, then it will spread all over the world. And they thought this is their mission. So what they did was they completely uprooted Christianity from its real purpose in order to make it spread widely, become the imperial religion and spread wide. Expediency over truth. So we have not been told the truth at all by the world. Now, Nestor said that the best you should do is call Mother of Christ. But he said that there's two natures, divine and human. He said, however, the human is a mere pretense. It's a device. It's a disguise. They call it a disguise. Yeah, but the better word is pretense. So he only seemed to have a human nature. So you can't say that there was a distinct human nature, then Mary was the mother of that human nature, which was actually also God in the flesh. You see, they had to. The whole idea of vicarious atonement is you have to have God in the flesh. God has to become flesh. This is what they insisted on, and this is simply not true at all. God, Spirit never becomes flesh. It's completely impossible. Flesh isn't even flesh, really. It's all a projection. It's all a camouflage. It's all a pretense. 100% pretense. It's like someone holding their breath, and their face turns red. Oh, like they seem like a different person. You know, struggling. Oh, I can't talk. I'm struggling. Does that mean there's some separate, different person there? No, they're just holding their breath. So Spirit is like pretending to be dead, and in this pretending to be dead, Spirit is giving rise to this appearancing that we call flesh, humans, body, call nature, world. This is all Spirit's play. It's pretense. So Nestor was much closer to the truth, but he was the one that lost out, and we've all lost out because of that, actually. But even Nestor was somewhat, you know, wishy-washy. And Docetism basically said that Jesus' entire situation here, it was just a phantom, a spiritual apparition, as it were. And that's actually true. That's actually the truth of it all. We're all just spiritual apparitions, actually. There's no such thing as the world. There's no such thing as the flesh. It's never existed. Never will. It's like a dream. It's only a dream. It is literally true. It's only a dream. It has no self-existence whatsoever. The idea was that Mary, the Mother of God, is to say that humanity has a self-existence. Okay, and this is a falsity, extreme falsity. Jesus says very clearly in Journey Beyond Words that the world has no self-existence. The body has no self-existence. Nature has no self-existence whatsoever. We are the absolute sovereigns of the universe, and we are simply dreaming up these props to make us seem like we're dead. That's all we're doing. To make Spirit seem like it's dead, because this is how Spirit is, this is the scheme, the plan that Spirit's following to try to be greater than God, believing that once Spirit is dead, then that will prove that God also is dead. God has to be dead too. And this will mean that Spirit, you know, killed God, had the stronger will. And then Spirit believes that because it had the stronger will, it's capable of resurrecting itself from spiritual death and being the new prime creator. This is the plan that we're following, thinking we'll succeed, and then that's the only way we'll find happiness. We think we have to succeed at this. So we have all these props, bodies, world. These are just dream props, imaginary, in our spiritual imagination, which is, you know, super, super potent. There's no end to its potency. We're just dreaming all this. So Docetism was essentially correct, and that got stamped out in the first century. And then Nestorianism, which was at least some homage to Docetism, got stamped out in the 5th century. And in between, there was a lot of back and forth. There was not an agreement at all. There were strong, strong disagreements about what to call Mary. Very strong disagreements. And the emperor said, hey, you Christians, you're squabbling too much among yourselves. You've got to come up with a unified creed, or else we're going to crack down on you. So keep this in mind, that the Christianity was under pressure from paganism, the Roman pagan empire, and the squabbling among Christians was caused severe crackdown on them. The Diocletian or something like that. Diocletus, some emperor that, you know, was viciously cracked down, killing Christians right and left, drove them in the catacombs. There's a lot of persecutions of the Christians, and the Christians were very much disunified over you know, what direction was the church going to take. So there was a lot of squabbles and fighting among the Jews, also Christians and the Jews and the Greeks, and were fighting, various and rebellions. And the emperor said, look, you get your house in order, or we're going to crack down on you really severely. So they said, you meet in a council, and you come up with a unified creed, and then enforce it upon all churches, and that's the end of the story. So that's what happened. That's what happened. But this hardly serves truth at all, does it? Basically, they just said, if you want to, you know, go along to get along, and come up with some unified creed, and then, you know, stop fighting among yourselves. So they banished Nestor. They're very, you know, said, kicked him out of the kingdom, basically. You cannot teach anymore. And they suppressed all, you know, various heresies that didn't agree with this creed in order to have, you know, be peaceful Christian communities within. And then from there, you know, the Roman Empire more, you know, embraced them more and more and more, and spread it further and further and further, and because it was unified and everyone was on the same page and you could administer it much more easily, and they didn't have all these squabbles, and people said, oh, these people really believe in what they're saying, there's no disagreement among them, so, you know, this is powerful. But, well, it was a political settlement, and the sword fell on someone. It fell on Nestor, Nestorius. It fell on them, those who said, wait a minute, we're not going to call Mary the Mother of God. No way. That's blasphemous. I mean, the idea of calling Mary the Mother of God was absolutely blasphemous to the early Christians. It was ridiculous. Jesus never gave her much honor at all, and rightfully so. The Mother has nothing to do with God the Father. I mean, the earthly mother here has nothing to do with the right belief system. The truth doesn't come from the earthly mother. It comes from the Holy Spirit. The Word of God is not in the mother at all. It's in the Holy Spirit, entirely in the Holy Spirit. So Jesus didn't get his truth and his virtue, you know, the spiritual charisma and everything from Mary, and Mary had nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. Just like our earthly mothers have nothing to do with our true spiritual understanding either. It comes from the Holy Spirit. So it's absolutely blasphemous to give any special merit to Mary at all. And they invented all sorts of stuff like perpetual virgin. That was an invention. But also there's a deeper meaning to all this, which is Mary means pure spaciousness, which is always immaculately virginal, and the appearances in pure spaciousness would be the sun, the type of thing. So there are ways to look at it from an esoteric standpoint, where the light of experiencing appears in the immaculate mother realm, so to speak, of pure spaciousness. If you want to look at it that way, you know, you. But this is not really the way that they presented it at all. They meant it literally, that there's two distinct different natures, and then God became flesh, and only by God becoming flesh could we be saved. They think that's the only way, and so Mary had to be the mother of God. They insisted upon it. Again, Jesus, no emphasis on the mother at all. He didn't say, hey, yeah, I am what I am because my mom's such a great mom and she raised me the right way and this is what. No, he rebuked his mother, actually. He left the family. He went about his, you know, his father's business. He didn't glorify or praise his mother or his father. Neither one, nor should we spiritually be engaged in that. But pagan clannishness is very much obsessed with the cult of human cult. The mother, the father, you know, this all important, right? This is where we get all our virtue, all our goodness, all of this, and that. No, we get our virtue and goodness is inherent because God created us perfect. We're spirit, we're not bodies. We're not bodies at all. We've never been bodies. So how can Mary be the mother of God in a physical body when we've never been bodies? Jesus explicitly says, I am not a body and I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. He explicitly said in the Bible, the flesh profiteth nothing. So how can you extol Mary as mother of God? It's ridiculous. And the early Christians did not at all. Not at all. It's only when these various philosophical squabbles broke out and the emperor got upset and then said, you Christians need to stop this, that then the politics entered and say, well, we have to come up with some agreement. You know, how are we going to go forward here and all agree? And the losers, you know, were branded heretics. Not that there weren't some heretical explanations like Arius, you know, like Jesus was adopted, Arian heresy. Jesus was fully a man, but he was adopted by God because of his virtue or something, you know. Well, they said that, no. But the Mary thing is central to the situation. And again, Jesus never said anything much about Mary, not in the Bible, not recorded just a normal mother, a normal father, really. And of course, in miracles and Journey of My Words, he's never said a word about mother or Mary or that anything like that, or his earthly father. Not a word, not one word. So we're either going to take it from Cyril of Alexandria and his allies and the politics and the emperor, Roman emperor, or we're going to take it from Jesus, you know, and that's a pretty easy choice. And Jesus says, loosen the world from everything you thought it was. Well, this is what pagans refuse to do. This is what mother worshippers refuse to do. They won't, and this is a step that has to be taken. And so they fixate at some point far away from that. And then claim and then build a religion upon that fixation, because they look and say, whoa, we can't go that far. No way. That's too much work, too difficult. I don't want to be shocked. I want to just enjoy life. And you know, so the pagans, they try to enjoy life. They try to, you know, live it up with their animals and their travels and whatever they do. The money, the influence, their friends, they try to have a good time. They don't want to spend time being shocked by the truth and saying, wow. Every day, like saying, holy cow, I really got shocked and stunned by the truth today. They say, how can you enjoy life that way? Come on, eat, drink, and be merry, and listen to good music, and drink fine wine, and this is the only life there is. You might as well enjoy it. You know, this is the pagan mindset. This is ruinous. This just causes them to get more and more entangled in projection. Their mind becomes more and more deranged, actually. So, in looking at the path, you see, oh my gosh, I have to go that far? Holy cow, I don't know if I can do this. Well, it's not easy, that's for sure. But you're going to be focused on something in life here. Your attention is going to be, you know, somewhere. So you might as well put it on what, make the right investment. You're going to invest in either in deranged mind or clear mind, a sane mind, either an insane mind or a sane mind. It's one of the two. That's the only investment we can really make here. Okay, so we're all investors here. This is something everyone has to wake up to the fact. We are all investing our time, attention, emphasis, belief constantly here. There's no way around it except when we go in full stop in the wild neutral mode. Okay. We can do that. We can say, well, let me just take a break from investing here. I just invested a huge amount of effort in truth, but I'm really shocked because I'm used to investing in lies. So let me take a little break from investing. So we can take a little break from that. It's not like we can stay in that constantly, but for 10, 15, 20 minutes, sometimes half an hour, or sometimes rarely an hour, we can be in this full stop in the wow mode. It takes discipline. It takes mental discipline to do this. Just let the mind go almost blank here, not thinking thoughts. Take a little break from running, just jog a little while. So we're running real fast and then we jog for a little while, that's all. The momentum of the wow is still bringing you forward automatically. Automatically. So, those who help out need to be unapologetic and need to be big picture. I already said I excommunicated the Pope. He's not fulfilling the role of the Good Shepherd at all. And then after that, I said it's the end of the church age. Officially, I said I closed the church age. Being a student of Jesus, I have this type of authority to say this, unapologetically say this, and not walk it back. And the church age is finished. I mean, and I brought it to light. The apocalypse brought it to light. It was a side trip. Now, what about the Protestants? Well, a lot of them have made some progress, for sure. They recognize the mistakes, and they have struggled forward. They need to do better. Let's put it that way. They need to do better. They're still stuck on the vicarious. A lot of them are stuck on the vicarious atonement, you know, the sacrificial atonement, and this and this and that. There's lots of places to get stuck. You know, it's not. We don't have to like hate one another. The fact that we're stuck on. We've all been stuck in getting free of this tar baby of arrogance. You know, it's really a terrible tar baby. Really. We've been embracing this tar baby, and now we want to get free of it. Oh my God, we're just so stuck. I grab this to pull this, and my hand gets stuck here, and I use this hand to get on stick, and this one gets stuck. And, you know, it's a really tough thing to get this incredibly sticky tar baby off of us. So, I just, you know, certainly the Protestants recognize this whole Mary thing with the church was paganism, sun-worshipping paganism. And the two distinct natures was, and the Eucharist also was very questionable, as I pointed out. It comes from, it's Egyptology, really. And some Protestants have gotten to the Holy Spirit, saying the Holy Spirit is the word, is the answer. This is a very good step. It means that they've made a lot of advancement, a lot. But you still have to then listen to what the Holy Spirit says. Okay, so there's still, you know, that is, it's like there's one more step to take. Once you get to realize that it's the Holy Spirit is the word and the truth, and this is that's what Jesus told us when we left. He said, I'm leaving. It's better for you if I leave, but I'm in my place. I'm going to leave the comfort of the Holy Spirit, which will clarify everything that you need to have clarified for you. So listen to the Holy Spirit. This is what my commandment to you. This is Jesus' real commandment. Listen to the Holy Spirit. That's the most important commandment. Listen to the Holy Spirit. So some Protestants have gotten to that, you see. And they realize this is important, this is important. The next step is to actually listen to the Holy Spirit. And in doing so, what you hear will be shocking, quite shocking. The clarifications are quite shocking. And so you have to go through this process of being, wow, I didn't see that before. Wow, I didn't see that before. Wow, I didn't realize this before. Wow, I didn't realize that planning, it means I must believe there's something wrong. Seeking a remedy means I must believe there's something wrong. And there isn't anything wrong. To believe that there's something wrong is the falsity that obscures the perfection of what I am, the perfection of I am nowness. So there is a period of that you go through where you're fighting off the heresy of Mariology and paganism disguised, and the dualistic nature of the Chalcedonian Creed. You're fighting off that. And so you're in sort of a negative mode. You know, you're defensive. And asserting the Holy Spirit, yeah. But not yet really to just listen to the Holy Spirit. So, we don't really know what the Holy Spirit really has to say. And we're just assuming, well, probably, I'm sure it says this. No, just don't assume. Let the Holy Spirit say what it wants to say. Oftentimes through dreams, it contacts us. And I have many dreams. Most nights I have dreams where I'm getting spiritual enlightenment in dreams from the Holy Spirit. And it's like just, wow. Very different than I expected. Very different than I believed. And it really shakes deep held beliefs. We have deeply held beliefs. Our structure of arrogance is such, defending arrogance, that it's very deep-seated, and we're so used to it, and shaking that up really, you know, hits us hard, you know, beyond what our intellect thinks, it hits us hard, hits us at our core, really hits us at our core. And so these core beliefs have to be brought into light, and this is what the Holy Spirit does. What the ego does is just try to do whatever it can do to induce us to keep waiting, so that it believes that if we just wait long enough, we'll be authentically dead. And it uses the marketing device of the mother as to convince us to keep waiting. Whereas, you know, the mother, the child's always impatient, right? And the mother is saying, just wait, child, just wait. And the child says, no, mommy, I want to do this. And she goes, oh, wait. So she says, how do I keep the child from, you know, running off or whatever? Here, let me give it some candy. Let me give it a hug. Look, come here, let me give you some affection. Let me give you a hug. Oh, look at this nice new clothes I have for you. Here's some candy. Here's some nice food. I'll sing you a song. You know, she tries to calm the child so that the child's impatient, saying, wow. You know, I feel like I want to go do something. And the mother says, no, just wait. So the impatience that we have for, we want truth. We said, hey, this world, I don't like it. I don't like trying to be dead. I want to drop this. And the ego says, no. The only way is to wait. It's got to wait a little longer. So it uses the mother symbology, which affects us all very strongly. It uses the goddess symbology of no, just wait a little longer. Look how beautiful nature is. Don't you like these? Let me just take a nature walk. Don't you enjoy the beautiful sky? Don't you enjoy, you know, all the flesh and, you know, just tries to like make nature and flesh and everything seem wonderful to us. We say, oh, well, it's not so bad. So maybe I'll just, you know, wait a little longer. This is the ego. The ego's entire stance is simply wait a little longer. That's it. It never says anything other than that. It never deviates from that one bit. It's just the ways and the means that it's trying to induce you to wait a little longer. Those can vary massively, extremely. But it's all the same. It's all saying just wait a little longer. That song, you know, wait a little longer, please Jesus. There are so many so many wandering in sin. Just a little longer, please Jesus. A little longer to get our loved ones in. It's always wait a little longer. This is the ego. Wait a little longer. Then you'll be authentically dead. This is all the ego can say. He says, well, you're not authentically dead yet, and you have to be, so all you can do is wait a little longer. That's the only strategy there is from this ego standpoint. That's the only option you have, is to wait a little longer. So it feels completely within its rights to trick us in every which way possible, because it feels that's the only option we have. No other option. Thinking that we've enraged God so severely that reconciliation with God is impossible. Now, what the Christian said was, oh, yeah, ego, we have enraged God to an extraordinary extent. But all that wrath got poured out on Jesus. So now God is in a conciliatory mood. The problem is, with this, it leaves all doors, you know, open to recidivism, and it's a lie that God was ever upset. Okay, so it's based on lies. The idea that God can get upset, you're believing in a false nature of God, completely false nature, and you cannot ever be reconciled to God as long as you believe that God was ever angry whatsoever. To believe that we ever sinned against God, it's impossible to be truly reconciled. Which is why then you have to bring Mary and say, well, that means, well, yeah, we have to be happy here in this world in some way, but somehow they'd say, well, we can get into heaven somehow. There's some true reconciliation, but the way they're going about it, you can never have a true reconciliation based on a false premise. That's why the Christology gets so confusing and absurd, gibberish, because they're trying to figure out, you know, like, how do we get a full reconciliation with God based on a false premise of denying the true nature of God, denying our true nature also, insisting that we did become, absolutely, we were human, absolutely, but how can humans be reconciled with the divine and all this? So they're working on reconciliation but using a false premise, which is why it gets muddied into this, all this massive confusion. You get St. Thomas Aquinas, you know, writing massive books and of apologetics. I mean, the Christian apologetics are just ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. You don't need apologetics. What do we need apologetics for? We just need the clear truth. You know, we don't need any apologetics. Jesus doesn't use apologetics at all in his teaching. So when I say it's the end of the church age, I mean it's the end of apologetics. It's the end of Christology, end of apologetics, all this stuff. We don't need any of that now. We have Jesus back who teaches us clearly. No need for any of that. Then we have students speaking out and amplifying what he's saying without using apologetics, being unapologetic about the truth completely. We cannot change the nature of God in any way. We can never sin against God. We can never change the will of God in any way. Therefore, there can't be any cause whatsoever of God being upset or angry or fearful or wrathful towards us at all. Therefore, we don't need any way to calm God down. We don't need to see that spirit can become flesh and be killed. That's just our old script of the way to happiness is we must die. And of course we leave out the fact that if we died, being an eternal idea in the mind of God, which can never be changed, if we actually die and change that, that means God has died, plain and simple. There's no way around that. There's no apologetics and get around that. So Jesus is just this unapologetic teacher, has no apologetics at all. And those who are heavily in apologetics find this very, very challenging. Like, wait a minute, what am I going to do with all my apologetics? Well, it's all rubbish. You know, it's all rubbish. So just gratefully set it aside and put it on the back burner. And it's shocking when you put your apologetics on the back burner because you thought that, or we have thought that, the only answer there is this apologetics. And basically apologetics is just confusion in attractive form. And ultimately, they say, well, you just have to have faith. And it's mystical, some sort of mystical faith that somehow this is true. We just can't see how it can possibly be true. They say, well, yeah, when you look at it, these apologetics are completely conflicting. And cannot possibly, mail delivery, cannot possibly be true. And we understand it's very confusing, but just take it on faith that it's all true anyway. And this is what we've been told. And we say, oh, you know, the vigor of these young historical people writing all these massive books. And we say, oh my God, I'm not going to read St. Thomas Aquinas and refute his apologetics, you know, step by step by step by step, and Aristotle, you know, and go through all this stuff, and Locke, and Hume, and Kant, and Wittgenstein, and, you know, just on and 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 on, Hegel. They tell you, well, you got to refute every last little bit. Say, oh, I can't do that. So he just collapses you and says, okay, you know, maybe I'll flee into Buddhism or flee somewhere. I'm like, I can't handle this. Yeah. No, you just have to state the truth unapologetically and say, here's an option to apologetics. Here's the unapologetic truth. Just do that instead. put them on the defensive. It's arrogance that needs to be on the defensive, not truth. It's arrogance that needs to walk back its position, not truth. Truth doesn't have to be apologetic at all. It does nothing to walk back about truth. Nothing at all to walk back. So it's arrogance that has to do the walking back. Now, what you need to do is you need to make it easy. We need to make it easy on ourselves to walk it back. And just go into this full stop in the wow mode. This is what makes it easy for us. To walk it back conceptually is torture. It doesn't work well at all. And we should all realize this by now. Because then you say, wait a minute, okay, now how do I argue this? How do I use apologetics to walk back apologetics? You know, it's like that. It's not really possible. You know, it just turns your mind into, it just thrashes your mind. You don't have to. It's the same thing like using the law. Jesus said, look, don't put new wine into old wineskins. He's saying, don't try to use the law to walk back the law. This is crazy. You're going to torture yourself. You're going to become so confused because you're already confused. It's like using confusion to walk back confusion. So just use unapologetic truth to walk back, to do the walking back for you. And then your role is to just go into the shock intentionally. Say, oh, I know, I'm shocked, no question about it. This is stunning. I didn't know you could do this. This is, you know, it's like almost heresy, but I'm not. If you say the glass is half empty, you're going to say this is heresy, this is blasphemous. If you say the glass is half full, you can say this is unapologetic truth, but it's shocking my familiarity. So I'm going to have to go through the shock. This is something I'm not familiar with. I'm not familiar with unapologetic truth. This is glass half full. So you have to be a glass half full person with discipline, with patience. And we all can be this. It's just a matter of emphasis, a matter of will. Have a positive outlook, glass half full. Our arrogance, the idea we could be greater than God was just sheer arrogance. And then arrogance came up with a scheme. As you would expect, arrogance to come up with a scheme. It came up with a scheme, said, this is, no, there's a way to do it. Of course, arrogance is going to say there's a way to do it. But that way is impossible. And of course, arrogance say, well, it's your fault. You just got to wait longer. Of course, what else is it going to say? You got to try harder. You got to wait longer. It eventually will work for you. That's the only position arrogance can say. You try to accomplish the impossible. It never happens. So it has to explain why it never happens. Well, you know, it will happen eventually. Well, how? We say, well, hypostatic union. You know, some sort of mystical hypostatic union. Vicarious. God will become flesh and God will die. And then that will prove that spirit has died. God has died. You know, and then all this confusion, apologetics around this. This is arrogance. This is arrogance saying eventually it will happen. That the impossible will eventually happen. This is all that arrogance can ever say. It will never happen. So all I can say is that it will eventually will happen, and there's got to be a plan. Arrogance doesn't say, well, we don't have any plan, but no, they say, oh, of course there's a plan. It's a very strict plan. We got the blueprint. This is why you need to give up plans, give up initiative, give up remedies, give up blueprints to be free, to feel bliss. This is what we have to do. Otherwise, we'll be enmeshed in the blueprints of arrogance, which are basically saying, just wait a little longer. We're almost there, just wait a little longer. That's all it can say. That's it. That's all it's ever said. It's never said anything other than that. Never will say anything other than that. We have to keep driving this point home, unapologetically driving this point home. And I know the thing is, if you're not in a mood of repentance and not being able to handle the wow, you'll get very upset and demand that the teacher apologize, saying, well, hey, you're pushing us too hard. You got to apologize for that. Walk it back what you're saying. No, cannot apologize for it. So it's up to the listener to realize that they have to manage the shock of the wow by going into this neutral mode and just relaxing for a while. See, right now I'm hissing, my buzzing, my mind is just shh. Wow. It's the unapologetic tone which is so important. And what those who are not truly engaging in a repentant frame of mind, they demand a change in tone. And the true teacher cannot change their tone. Otherwise, they're being ineffective, teaching a mixed message, and then just people are getting nowhere, spinning their wheels. Wheels are coming off. It's not working. Waste of time. The tone has to be unapologetic. And this is what the world hates so much. Is there anyone in the world with a truly unapologetic tone? Very few. Very few, if any, that are truly unapologetic. Their whole tone is truly unapologetic. And what those who are not in repentant frame of mind do is they come to those teachers and say, hey, we need to tone you down a little bit. So they try to find ways to do that. If the teacher is a man, a lot of the women come and try to get into a sexual relationship with the teacher. Why? To help tone the teacher down. They say, hey, this will help tone you down. They try to get into some relationship, you know, in some way. Or even the men will try to do that. You know, but there'll be all sorts of ways that people who are not practicing full stop in the wow, if they don't practice full stop in the wow, they will automatically, they'll either leave or they will try to tone the teacher down. So the tone is an apologetic tone. Okay. Which then, that's what arrogance loves. Oh, yeah. So that's a waiting tone. So, okay, I'm going to wait. I'll wait a little longer. I'll still believe in arrogance. I'll keep waiting a little longer. And then they don't have to worry about the wow. Always, okay, the tone is one of waiting, so there's no wow. When the tone is unapologetic, then there's shock there. There's wow there. Wow. They're not walking this back. They're saying this, and then they're not walking it back. Wow. That's a stunner. We're so used to arrogance having its say. That when there's someone who simply dismisses arrogance and doesn't let it have its say at all, we're very stunned by this. That's why sometimes you come across a real teacher. I've had experiences in various ways. And first of all, you think, wow. You say, this is great. The teacher's really being very, very dynamic and speaking clearly the truth. This is great. And so you take it in. And but then after a while you start sort of having a different tone. You say, this is really something. What's going on? Well, what's happening is that you're expecting the teacher then their tone to shift into giving arrogance its quote unquote fair equal time, so to speak, equal time, as if going in opposite directions, just going back and forth in opposite directions, as if that were some sort of spiritual path. No, that's just spinning our wheels and waiting. That's just an advanced, tricky form of waiting, saying, well, I'll give equal time to arrogance and truth, and I'll just go back and forth. What are you doing if you're just going back and forth, going this way, this way, this way? You're just waiting. And it's just a very sophisticated excuse of waiting. No, I'm giving spirit a good equal time, too, you know. No, that doesn't do anything. You're just stuck, stagnating, and waiting. So what happens with a genuine teacher is the tone doesn't shift. It's still unapologetic. And the more it goes on this way that's unapologetic, the more shocked you are. And eventually you start feeling really, really shocked. You say, wait a minute. I've never experienced this before. The arrogance is not speaking here? What's going on? So we can be very used to some people being adamant, speaking the truth, and then later shifting their tone and being apologetic about it. And we say, oh yeah, that's great. That's good. It helps us wait. That's very helpful for us. And thank you, Goddess, for helping us out, help us wait more, because that's the only option that we have for happiness. You know, so thank you for that, because I was getting nervous that I might really start listening to just truth, only truth. But now I can give truth and then arrogance and give them equal time. It's called being fair. You know, we need to be fair to arrogance. Why do we need to be fair of arrogance? Truth is what has always been. Arrogance is just an attempt to be an interloper there. You don't have to be fair to arrogance. Arrogance can never be true. Truth can never be walked back. So there isn't any issue of fairness. Truth is true, nothing else is true. So, but if we want to wait for our spirit to die so God can die and be greater than God, we often use this way of, we listen to truth and then we listen to arrogance. Listen to truth, listen to arrogance. So we're very used to that. And we'll put up with that. The ego will say, oh, no problem. You can read that book, sure, go ahead, no problem. And then give me equal time and we'll call it good. This doesn't work. this absolutely doesn't work. And so when you meet someone, a teacher is really telling the truth unapologetically, they don't shift back into voice of arrogance. It's not there. And then you start panicking. You say, holy cow, what's going on? This is frightening. This is what it really is shocking. It's wow. And then right away you need to identify the wow and say, wow, I'm being hit by the wow. What do I do about it? Oh, I need to practice what? Full stop in the wow. I need to keep it a glass half full. Glass is half full. I don't need to say, oh, this is a cult. This is brainwashing. This isn't being fair. The fearful thing, like, oh, I'm going to be destroyed. I'm going to be annihilated. I'm not advancing. This is terrible. This is glass half empty. Let me argue. Let me conceptualize. What's your position? Let's say you go to the ego. That's glass half empty. Whereas glass half full is saying, oh, great. Here's a teacher that's unapologetic, has an unapologetic tone. Fantastic. But this is certainly, I'm not used to that. Nobody's used to that in this world. There is nobody in this world that is fully used to this at all. You know, absolutely not. It's still shocking. I've been at it for almost 40 years. It's still shocking. You know, wow. It still brings on the wow. So we embrace the wow and say, great, this is really shocking. Let me get used to this. Let me take a little breather here. So I can go on with this. In order to go on with this, I got to take a little breather. Instead of attacking it or fleeing from it or attacking or something, that's glass half empty reaction. That, you know, doesn't help at all. Because people say, hey, wait a minute, I thought you were helping me wait, and you're not helping me wait. I'm angry at you at that. No, the real teacher is not helping anyone wait. They're helping us shed this waitingness, this waitingness, shed that. Evaporate it, so we don't need to keep waiting for the impossible to happen. Give up our plans, our initiative, our remedies, initiative and plans. And when we do that, we'll rest in peace. We'll rest in the peacefulness of our intrinsic nature, our one and only unchangeable nature, which is flawless. Flawless freedom. And as we're here in this world, we'll experience it as this great sense of contentedness and relaxation and peace and bliss, but still not having the, as long as we're engaging with this world at all, we will not have this feeling of absolute freedom, this absolute freedom that we truly are. But that's okay. The intermediate step is good enough for now, for sure. How are we doing on this? Okay, we've gotten up, we've done something substantial here. So you see how without the basics, you can never get the momentum you need. You can never look as deeply as you need to look. And so those who do not approach it in the right way never succeed, and they only get fixated, and some then blather on about how advanced they are, etc. Nobody else, and no one else can be any more advanced than this. This is it. And this is what happens. And sooner or later, someone comes along who blows your cover. You know, then people don't like this. I was aware that people, spiritual teachers, didn't like me because I was going to blow their cover, because they were fixated. They hadn't gone all the way, and so they were fixated, and they tried to convince others that this was it. And they said, I hope nobody comes along that blows my cover. What they're really saying is, I hope that everybody's fixated and nobody actually gets to the truth. The true, you know, and is truly unapologetic about the truth, because that's going to blow my cover. So they really then become negative towards the spiritual path and trying to prevent others from going all the way. This is what happens. So I felt very unwelcome by spiritual teachers in the world, because I was someone with the capacity to blow their cover. You know, not because I was trying to, but just because the tone that I had would blow their cover, unapologetic tone. They say, whoa, 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 we need to tone that down. So there was a massive effort to tone me down. And this is what happens. Anyone who comes in here who really wants to spread the truth, the world turns on them and says, whoa, tone it down, tone it down, tone it down. You can't have that here. And look, my spiritual teacher doesn't like that tone. They told me to tone it down. They're, you know, most spiritual religious teachers in the world are actually fixated. They're stuck. And they're just trying to make the most of it, make lemonade out of it, and saying, well, this is as far as anyone can go. Anyone who says that anything go any further, heresy, you know. Nah. False. Side trip. They didn't get it. So the real teachers will teach you about this process of going ever deeper and how to manage your shock of going deeper and deeper and deeper. More core. Bring the core to light. The core false beliefs, the core of arrogance. Bring it to light. How to manage the shock of that. This is real teaching. Because once you know how to manage the shock of it, nobody can stop you from going all the way. No one can stop you. You have the tools. It's like teaching a carpenter. Once they know how to the tools, they can build their own house. They can build as big a mansion as they can afford, you know. Nothing can stop them. Once they learn all the basics of building, who can stop them from building what they want to build? Nobody. Just same thing. Once you get the know-how to manage the wow, nobody can stop you from going as deep as you want to go. So this is true open-ended teaching that we have here, giving you the tools that you need, not just the dogma, but the tools. The tools are primary, and then the teaching is goes along with it. But the tools here are primary. That's why every video I stress the tools, right? Use of the tools. And how can you get a carpenter feel very self-sufficient if they don't really know how to use their tools? They might have their tools, but they're just showcasing. Yeah, but they don't really know how to use them properly. It's not going to help them build whatever they want to build. They're still dependent. But if a carpenter is really schooled very, very clearly in how to use the tools properly, knows how to do all the cuts and the right use of all these tools, then they feel very self-sufficient. They can build anything. I know carpenters like that. They're not dependent on someone else telling them what to do. If they want to build something, they say, I know how to build it. I know how to use the tools. I know how to do it. I'm very proficient at it. A lot of carpenters are very self-sufficient. They say, I can go anywhere, build anything, any place. So they feel very independent. If there's not work here, well, we'll move some other place in the country where there's work, and we'll work there. If I don't want to work for this client, I'll work for somebody else I like better. Because I have the tools to I know I can build whatever anyone wants. So it's the same way in the spiritual path. You have to be self-sufficient to some extent here, to a large extent. And no, I can just sit down anywhere, wherever I am, whatever time it is, whatever age I am, whatever, and I can focus in and go deeper into the truth, and I can handle the shock of this. I'm not really dependent on any teacher, actually. And that's not to say that I won't have a teacher that is giving me encouragement and assistance and helps is good at, you know, bringing up, helping me go deeper, sure. But I'm not, you know, completely dependent on that. I have the Holy Spirit is with me. Holy Spirit is with me, always. And can always bring my attention deeper, absolutely. Now, Jesus is very helpful to help bring our attention deeper. But I don't have a sense like of complete dependence on that necessarily. But I'm also smart enough to say, hey, if it's helpful, then use it. Right? Absolutely. Use all of it. Use it to the ultimate extent. If something is a gold mine, you know, mine the gold. Jesus is a gold mine of assertion, of unapologetic assertion.